following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
It's Empty Wheel Friday on the Nicole Sandler Show.
We get together every week at the end of the week to talk about what happened during the week. Marcy Wheeler is here from emptywheel.net. I'm Nicole Sandler, a little bit off today, taking a new medication which knocked me on my ass. So, Marcy, I'm going to really shut up today and let you do most of the talking, which is a good thing because, go figure, this was another just crazy week. I mean, if I had to put a name on it, I'd say this is a clusterfuck. This whole week on so many fronts. The big story, of course, is the Hunter Biden trial, which you'll fill us in on. But
the big story is Steve Bannon is going to prison.
Yeah,
just
well,
in time for July 4th.
Thank goodness.
And also, they're finally putting Alex Jones into Chapter 7. So the Sandy Hook families are finally going to get some recourse for him for fucking up their lives. So
yes,
that's good news.
Both that
of
is
those
good news.
Are good news. And also people who followed the Charles McGonigal story, he also reported to prison. So he's now in prison, the former New York field office counterintelligence head. So those things all happened while
right.
we were paying attention to Hunter Biden.
Yes. And as did more, I got fuck ups with Eileen Cannon. And then the Georgia appeals court has indefinitely put that case on hold, really, because they can't decide if whether or not Fani Willis should be taken off the case.
The Georgia, once they took the appeal, it was pretty likely that the appeals court was going to put it on hold. That according to Georgia experts on Georgia courts, that was to be expected. So once they took the appeal, and again, the same experts were like, the standard here is not actually very clear. So it wasn't surprising. They took the appeal. It wasn't surprising. They put it on hold. Again, the fault here is Fani Willis.
Yes,
the fault here is for Fani Willis blowing the most important case she was going to deal with. So let's put that aside, but we're not going to get any other trial. There's a possibility we'll begin the January 6th trial in D.C. before the election, but we will not get a verdict before the election. So take that off your elections plan. We also, the Trump campaign, one of the other things that happened this week, which is insane, one of the many insane things. First of all, pro-Russian apologist, I should say, David Sachs, who is a Elon Musk advisor, put together a massive fundraiser for Trump in San Francisco. These are a bunch of oligarchs who, I mean, they are billionaires and they are very friendly to Vladimir Putin. So this is the oligarchization that, just like Russia has of Donald Trump's campaign, and he's going there. The other thing that happened this week, which is scary, is that on Trump's orders, Speaker Mike Johnson put Scott Perry, right? So the key yep. coup conspirator, and
Ronnie Jaxson,
the pill mill guy, onto the House Intelligence Committee. So
yeah.
Trump has ordered Mike Jaxson to put these two wildly unqualified people onto the House Intelligence Committee ahead of people who, did important things on the intelligence world in the last 6 months. So they're sort of disgruntled about it. But Trump is making moves that make it clear that he has no intention of contesting this election fairly. Like he's already, he put another January 6er in a key role at the RNC along with Christina Bob. There is no pretense on the part of the RNC at this point that they will not assault the entire idea of democracy to make sure that Donald Trump gets power. So that's where we're at.
Yeah, no, it's
meanwhile,
it's
we can talk about Hunter Biden because I first want to talk about the reporting on Hunter Biden because it's driving me nuts. Over the course of this week, so Hunter Biden on trial for three gun charges. Over the course of this week, New York Times did a Maggie and Jonathan Swan piece where they said no one that Trump had targeted during his term as president had been charged. And I'm like, dudes, like Hunter Biden is literally on trial as we speak.
Hello.
And Donald Trump literally personally intervened in that case over and over and over in ways that are completely unprecedented. And you're claiming that no one got charged. Hunter Biden is on trial today because of things that Donald Trump and Bill Barr did.
Right.
There's no question in my mind that Hunter Biden would not be where he is today if were it not for things that Bill Barr and Donald Trump did. So that's one, New York Times.
Right. And then, also didn't Joe Biden, as an aside, said he would not pardon Hunter if he's found guilty of anything. So again, proving that that he's letting the Justice Department do what they do and disproving Trump's claims that Biden is controlling everything. If that makes
right.
sense.
And I mean, I will tip my hand. I think that prosecutors put on a very strong case. There are three charges, two form charges, like, did you lie on this form? And a third charge, which is at any time between the time you purchased the gun on October 11th and the time it was disposed of on October 23rd, were you either using controlled substances or an addict? And I think it highly likely that the jury will find him guilty on that charge. We'll see. So as we speak, we always have to say this. We take right. in midday East Coast time, morning your time, afternoon my time. And as we speak, Hunter Biden has called the first two witnesses in his defense. They're the gun shop guys. And there's this outrage. People are like, oh my God, did the gun shop guys fabricate the form? I'm like, yeah, dudes, I've been telling you that. Like,
yes.
did I say that Friday or did that develop over last
weekend? No, we talked about it last week. Yeah.
Right. So on the morning of trial, Judge Noreika prohibited Hunter Biden from raising this at all, from raising the fact that the gun shop doctored the form that records his gun purchase. A couple of years after the fact. We actually don't know whether it happened in 2020 or 2021, but regardless. So Hunter Biden called the government called the sales guy who sold him the gun and said, oh, he did everything proper. And Hunter Biden, and we won't know until I see the transcript. I'm not there, right? Hunter Biden probably made a materiality argument. So for the two form charges, and this is, sorry, a bit in the weeds, but if people are tuning in, then they're used to it from me. But the two form charges, one requires the form to be material. So in other words, if Hunter Biden hadn't filled out the form properly, would they have sold the gun to him? Well, they did.
Yes.
Because he didn't provide a second form of ID. And therefore the answer is yes, they would have sold him the gun regardless.
And they did.
And then the second thing is that the second count requires the gun shop to keep the form and keep the form in certain, like if you doctor it after the fact, which again, they did. But the judge won't let Hunter Biden tell the jury that if they doctor it after the fact, then they have to do certain things and they didn't do those things. And so again, I think that it's likely the jury will find him guilty on the possession charge and we can talk about why. But I think there is a decent chance this stuff will, and it should, will lead the jury to raise questions about whether they can convict him on the two form charges. And that's important because, people who haven't been following the case very closely are like, oh, he can appeal. This is the charge that may get thrown out by the Supreme Court almost imminently. And for example, Sarah Isger, who was the DOJ spokesperson who released Peter Strzok's and Lisa Page's texts. By the way, Merrick Garland said that that was unlawful this week, and we expect to see a settlement from that. Oh. But anyway, Sarah Isger did this op-ed saying, oh, Hunter Biden should plead right now. And I'm like, no, he can't do that for a variety of reasons. And one of the reasons he can't do that is even if the Supreme Court throws out the possession charge, there were still these two document charges, and prosecutors had already said, we think the document charges stand even if they throw out the possession charge. So Hunter needs to do things to throw out the document charges. That is happening as we speak, that he called the guy who said, who said to the guy who sold the gun, you need to get a second form of ID. And then he called the gun shop owner, and we don't know. I'm like, again, it's happening as we speak. We'll see what that happens. That gun shop owner, the other thing that Judge Nareka is keeping off the stand is that gun shop owner released these forms in 2020 as part of an effort to influence the election. And so, for example, and this part may actually come in, the government put the receipt of all the stuff that Hunter Biden purchased into the record. And I looked at it and I was like, you know, first of all, why did it take 16 minutes between the time that the gun was purchased and the time he actually walked out the door? But I also found that on the receipt, it says printout date, and the printout date is October 2020. And so they had to make a reprint out, and it shows that it was printed out at a time when it should not have been. And the government introduced that themselves. Like, that's not my doing. Right. So I think so that may be a way to talk about the fact that the gun shop owner was literally working with one of the Delaware cops, the Delaware cop who had lead of the investigation back in 2018. They were working on concocting a story, so it made it look worse for the Bidens and made it look like they hadn't broken the law.
Here's my question about this. The documents, okay, this is a big part of it, but the judge is not allowing in the fact that they doctored the dates, at least changed them. No.
They did doctor the dates. It's crystal clear that they doctored the dates. It's crystal clear that they doctored the form to add a second form of ID. And by the way, this is hilarious that they said, not thinking very much about it, that that Hunter Biden, his second form of ID was a Delaware car registration. The car he drove to the gun shop was not his car. It was dad's car. So it's impossible they would have looked at that and relied on that.
So and, right there, though, isn't that grounds for appeal? I mean, right, that her...
Well, the fact that she excluded it is grounds for appeal. Yeah, and so that's one of the things I was saying to Sarah Isger is like, you can throw out the main possession charge for constitutional grounds, and there will still be these two document charges there that you need to find some way to get rid of. As we speak, Abby Lowell is doing something. It's been this tension all week where every time he gets close to this, the prosecutors object, and Judge Nareka is like, oh, I'm not letting you bring that in. The gun shop is not on trial. And it's like, well, maybe we should talk about why they're not on trial, because, you know, basically what David Weiss chose to do. Well, let me go back. I've said from the start that I think Hunter Biden was offered that what's called a sweetheart deal last summer, not because he didn't cheat on his taxes and not because he didn't buy a gun, but because the evidence supporting those things is so undermined by things like doctoring the, you know, like it's been politicized from the start. Mm-hmm. This whole thing has been political, you know, like the one of the first cop who responded wrote his police report in such a way that, first of all, was almost certainly not true, but second of all, was designed to be leaked later to New York Post. And guess what? It was leaked later to New York Post to create some kind of storm in advance of Joe Biden's reelection. And so, like, normally prosecutors, when they see a case that is infused with all this kind of corruption, they don't charge it because it's going to come out. The two prosecutors that are prosecuting this, one's a guy named Leo Weiss. He is a good prosecutor. There are people who will vouch for him. I've been following his work since 2006, I think. I knew coming in that I use the term prosecutorial dickishness again. I want to make clear I'm not saying they are violating their ethical guidelines. Moral guidelines, sure, but prosecutors are given a wide leash to do the kinds of things that Leo Weiss has done his entire career. I mean, one of the reasons Leo Weiss is sort of the case that I had followed before, and I think I've described this before, was Joseph Nocio's case, who was the CEO of Quest. And he was prosecuted for fraud. And he was prosecuted. He's like, this is selective prosecution. You're coming after me because I refused to participate in Stellar Wind. And they managed to keep that out of the trial record. They managed to avoid dealing with that argument at trial. in very much the same way that Leo Weiss has managed to keep this crap out of the Hunter Biden case until today. And when more documents about Stellar Wind were released after the Edward Snowden releases, I looked at it and I'm like, you know, he was right. Like, he literally said, I'm not going to do your illegal garbage. And then shortly after that, you know, they came after him for fraud. And so I think that Leo Weiss was brought in precisely because of his track record of being able to keep stuff like this out of cases, because they knew, and it's not just the gun shop and it's not just the cops. It is so riven with problems, and they have succeeded up till now at keeping this evidence out. We'll see what happens by the end of the day. The other,
and also on the stuff not being allowed in, I can't help but always remember that Judge Noriega is a Trump appointee, and like Eileen Cannon, she seems to be doing his dirty work.
Yeah, I want to hesitate before I say that Judge Noriega and Judge Scarcy, who's the Trump appointee in Los Angeles, who, I mean, they're both judge, both of them, Noriega and Scarcy, and Betsy Woodruff Swan had an interesting piece this week about their judgments. They're both, she was a patent lawyer. He has a background as a computer guy. And so they were hired appropriately for the jurisdiction to bring some technical expertise to things. And a lot of Judge Noriega's decisions are the decisions of somebody who's used to civil cases, not criminal cases. And so, for example, I think there's a lot wrong with her decision on the immunity deal, but it, you know, there's a logic to it if you approach it as if you're used to civil cases. She, like, I think her exclusion of some of this gun shop shenanigans, you know, she's thinking, I can't prejudice either side. And it's like, no, this is a criminal case. Like, you can't prejudice the defendant. You have to allow him his Sixth Amendment right to confront his accusers. And she, I think, until today, had prevented a lot of that from coming in. So I don't want to rush to impugn her on a political ground, because I think she's smart. She's, you know, I also think she doesn't like Abby Lowell, and she's warming up to Abby Lowell. But I think, you know, Abby Lowell is a pushy lawyer, and he is he's used to success. And I think that rubbed her the wrong way, and it rubbed her the wrong way in a way that I, as a woman, might also be rubbed the wrong way. You know what I mean? Like, he talks over people and that pisses her off. So little things like that.
Okay.
Anyway, so here we are at trial. The prosecution has succeeded so far in keeping these shenanigans out of the trial record. But I think that there is enough that may lead the jury to have reasonable doubt about the documents cases. What happened yesterday is, like, I, from the start, I've been saying this case, or at least the possession case, Hunter Biden owned a gun for 11 days, and the jury has to decide over those 11 days whether he either was an addict and knew he was an addict, viewed himself as an addict, or whether he was doing controlled substances. If one or the other is true and they can reach unanimity on one or the other, then he's guilty.
Wow. Well,
that simple.
Are these cases routinely prosecuted?
No, they're never, ever prosecuted, and especially like this. And, yes. And you know, and there's the possibility that the jury is going to what's called nullify, that they're going to say, look, you know, I know what the law is, but this is ridiculous. Don't do this. And there's a little bit, like, you know, Abby Lowell is going to make clear that for years, nobody decided to charge this. And then all of a sudden they charged it. I mean, it's clear. I suspect that this morning, although I didn't, you know, I started this rant by talking about the media cover. Let me finish the media coverage and then go back to the evidence. Or should do the evidence or go back to the media coverage?
Up to you.
I'll do the evidence. So, so from the start, I've said, this case comes down to Hillary Biden. Hillary Biden, remember, Bo Biden's widow, but after his death, she and Hunter kind of fell into this relationship, and they were both, struggling, and they both ended up doing drugs, Hunter a lot more. And in the period in question in 2018, he is having this affair with a dancer, who testified as well. Her name's Zoe Kasten. And they, Hunter and Halle, have been incredibly jealous of each other for a year. So that's the background. They're like insanely jealous of each other. Hunter especially, is his addictions are beginning to take over his life. Hunter starts this relationship with Zoe Kasten at the same time that he and Halle are sustaining this relationship. And they're both trying to get clean. Like, right. One of the things that's come out, and one of the things that's interesting is the jury has, I don't know, 3, 4, 5 people on it whose family members have had real struggles, yes. And in some cases, some deaths of overdoses. And then there's a couple of people with law enforcement experience. There's like a Secret Service person whose spouse, I mean, she was like a documents person, and her spouse was somebody who was on the protective side. And then there's somebody else who worked for cops, or, you know, the idea is this is a really, really interesting jury for this case.
Yes.
Also, like, you know, the time I couldn't get on a jury before they kicked me off, they kicked off anybody with any kind of felony ties, like not just them, but, you know, like, oh, my brother has a felony record. Really? They kicked them all off, which happened to kick off all the black people. It was a case of a black person accused of arson against a prominent Greek American family in the neighborhood. You know, there are a number of people on the jury who've had experience with the law, with the legal justice system themselves. So it's a really curious jury. Possibility that they'll say, this is a ridiculous charge. You should never charged it. We're going to vote, you know, we're going to vote against it, even though he's clearly guilty.
Mm-hmm.
But I, you know, I guess what I'm saying is you can believe, and Hunter is making a solid case, that he did no crack in those 11 days.
Okay.
That's one argument he's making. And one of the things the prosecutors have done is they've come in with a bazooka and they're like, look at all these, you know, look at all this evidence of drug use, look at all, and all the use of, all of the use with three exceptions, all the use of drug use is well before or well after those 11 days.
Okay.
And in fact, they're close to, they have, Hunter Biden did rehab in August 2018. He and Halle apparently went to rehab event. That's why he came back to Delaware October 6, 2018. So he was doing all these rehab events, you know, and they were in the AA system already.
Huh.
Now, they were close to arguing that there's no evidence he was doing drugs between August and when he bought the gun and when he got rid of the gun. That, you know, there's no witness to that. Now, Zoe Kasten saw Hunter in mid-September 2018. Mm-hmm. This is the dancer.
Right.
And she claims he was doing drugs at that time. Now, what's interesting is she took pictures of everything during this entire period. And all of the pictures have drug paraphernalia in it. Except that one in September has no drug paraphernalia in it.
Interesting.
So, you know, thus far, like, did Zoe really see him do drugs in September 2018? I don't know. She described Hunter being at some meeting and she didn't believe at the time it was rehab related. She didn't, like, not, you know, they had, and this was very showy, they had both Zoe Kasten and Hunter Biden's ex-wife testify about all these drugs he did. Neither of them even knew where he was in October 2018.
Wow.
So they not only don't know that he was doing drugs in October 2018, they can talk about all the drugs he was doing before and after, but neither of them witnessed him doing drugs.
Who could remember what you did in 2018 if you, you know, one night got high? I mean,
right. And here's the thing. So Halle Biden, and, you know, we're going to learn how they got her to testify. I mean, we know that she was immunized. We know that she said, I don't want to testify, you know, incriminate myself. And they forced her to. They got an order from the judge that she had to. Mm-hmm. And this day was incredibly traumatic for her. So anytime you suffer trauma, obviously your memory is shot. So first of all, her memory was shot on that day. And then she's been coached by prosecutors and she's under some pressure from prosecutors. So her memory on the stand was really fraught. Mm-hmm. And then on top of that, like, prosecutors were able to pick and choose which communications they wanted to get in.
Okay.
It is true that an FBI agent testified that that they had not seen any form of tampering in the communications she had reviewed. It's also true that she's not qualified to do that. She wasn't asked to do that. And she was only given an amazing cherry pick of files. So, for example, she didn't see emails. She didn't see the metadata of emails.
Okay.
So she didn't see, for example, something I've seen, which is you can see people trying to compromise his Rosemont Seneca account throughout this period. You can see, for example, that his Droid Hunter account, which was the one he used with Adult Entertainment, that one was compromised in November of 2018, it looks like. And that account, a burner phone logged into that account in the period where I think his digital life was packaged up. So if you look at these things, you can actually see signs of compromise. They just cherry picked all the comms that came in and you didn't see any of those. Though Zoe Keston, again, the dancer, she described that Hunter, and this is stuff I had been raising from the start, Hunter would give her and drug dealers 5-minute codes so they could go use his ATM account.
Oh, wow.
Without him being present. Hunter gave her his credit card so she could make hotel reservations. Hunter would use her laptop at different periods. Hunter lost 5 to 6 phones while she was with him over the course of their relationship was about a year. And so she's describing that his digital life was always in the state of half compromise, which is what I've argued, right?
Right.
The problem is for prosecutors, to prove that his life wasn't compromised intentionally, you would have to go to every drug dealer,
yes,
including, you know, the drug dealer he was working with in the summer of 2018 has some ties to Russia, right?
Oh my God.
So, and there was a Russian escort that he was fucking in August of 2018. And so there's, you know, Hunter said, they stole my laptop in August 2018. And he's like, I think they did it to compromise me. He said that in December of 2019 before his laptop got all packaged up and brought to a computer repair guy. So,
right.
So anyway.
Yeah. So has the laptop come in yet? Okay.
Yes. Yeah. But what they did, and again, this is grounds for appeal, but what they did is they didn't bring in the FBI experts to say we've authenticated this. They brought in just this summary witness who saw a cherry-picked set of communications, and they either didn't bring in ones that were suspect. I think there were ones that were suspect, or Abby Lowell chose not to push it for reasons that Abby Lowell probably is a lot smarter than all of us.
Uh-huh.
If it comes out, for example, that the FBI actually learned in real time that the laptop was compromised, then the entire case gets thrown out on Brady grounds. This is the point. Taking this case to trial, winning it, and sustaining it with all this shit, assuming that it's not all going to blow up in your face, is what they've done. And let's see how long it lasts. Let's see how the document fraud, you know, the gun shop. I mean, it is literally the case that David Weiss chose to immunize because the gun shop owner was given a proffer, meaning anything he says, so long as it's true, can't be used against him. And so this gun shop owner who basically admitted that they doctored the forms years after the fact, admitted that they did so in 2021. So the statute's limitation on those crimes haven't expired. And it's like, who is more important for you to prosecute? A guy who owned a gun in 2018
for 11 days
has stayed sober as far as we know since then, or a gun shop that is willing to doctor forms after the fact?
Yes.
Well, and David Weiss chose to prosecute Hunter Biden, not the gun shop.
Right. Now, the gun shop owner, what he's saying is the reason that the forms weren't filled out entirely or whatever, he had to go back and fix them, is because he so wanted Joe Biden's son out of his shop. Is that right?
Yeah, he said, this was an interview he did 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago now, where he said, you know, I realized it was Joe Biden's son and I didn't want him in my store. I didn't want, you know, I didn't want people to see him in the store. And again, he coordinated with friends and a cop in 2020 to share this story, I think, with The Blaze, with right-wing media.
Oh, God. Yeah, that was Glenn Beck's thing, right?
Oh, was it?
Blaze,
oh,
yes.
Lovely. Yeah. Yes. So in other words, yeah, he's a partisan. And I think that, you know, I think the cop from day one was like, oh, I'm going to get Hallie Biden. I'm going to get the Bidens. And so I'm going to flop. Like, he asked the cop who actually interviewed Hallie, asked Hallie, did you, he basically asked to get their phone records. He said, oh, I think this is really suspect. I'm going to go get their phone records. And instead, Delaware shut down the case. But again, this from the start, like, I mean, how long has the right wing been gunning for Hunter Biden? And all of these people on the case have been gunning for Hunter Biden. And I suspect in 10 years, we'll learn that literally everyone from day one to day, you know, we're 5, 6, 10 years into this, we're 3,600 days into this, everyone was gunning for Hunter Biden. But the question is, what happens between now and the election? What, you know, does Hunter Biden go to prison? So let me finish the Hallie and then I'll talk about the shitty media coverage. Okay. And then we can get you off and send you back to bed again. So, so basically the ex-wife and the dancer, their testimony isn't that damaging, except if you believe the dancer when she says that when she saw him in September 2018, he was still doing drugs. There's no, you know, like, let's see about that. But that's not all that damaging, right? Mm-hmm. Because Hunter mm-hmm. Biden has said, I've been an addict, sometimes in, sometimes out. Same with most of the communications. Most of the most damning communications, like you see him buying drugs in May of 2018. You see him buying drugs in February of 2019. There's one instance of in December of 2018, I think it is. So that's the communications evidence of him buying drugs. Then there are, you know, of course, we know tons of videos of him with crack pipes. But those, again, from a different time period, not from this 11-day time period. And the memoir, really sleazy, sleazy stuff. And from day one, the other prosecutor, Derek Hines is his name, and I think he's a goofball. He's the one, we have to do this every show now. He's the one who claimed that sawdust was cocaine. Oh, so yes. Sawdust is cocaine, Derek Hines. From day one, these prosecutors have said, well, of course we have to prosecute this. Look at this memoir. He admitted that he was an addict. And it's like, well, first of all, he admitted he was an addict after he got sober. But second of all, the memoir doesn't help you to prove that he was doing drugs in those 11 days in October, because he doesn't talk much about that time period.
Huh. Okay.
And prosecutors have persistently used how he looked, used what he wrote about his time in February of 2019 and misrepresented it and claimed that that's what he was like in October of 2018. Just dishonest, sleazy stuff. And because in the memoir, when he goes back to Delaware, he's like, I went back to see if I could, you know, make good with Hallie and get sober. Mm-hmm. After he leaves Keith Ablow's treatment, and after in the memoir, he says, oh, Keith Ablow's treatment made me worse. It made me backslide because it basically made me face my demons for 8 weeks. And crack addicts really shouldn't be sitting with their demons alone. So after Keith Ablow got to him mm-hmm. in his memoir, as he describes, that's when he was like, oh, it was me and a crack pipe and in Motel 6 or Circle, whatever, one of the cheap motels. And over and over again, four times now, I've caught the prosecutor claiming that that February 2019 description is Hunter Biden's description of where he was in October of 2018. Over and over. Correct, 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 correct. Wow. They did it again before the jury yesterday. And it's the narrative equivalent of a dirty cop taking a crack pipe and putting it in somebody's kitchen that they want to frame.
Right.
You know, what he's doing is taking the narrative description of Hunter Biden's crack pipe from February of 2019 and placing it before the jury as if Hunter Biden was using that crack pipe in October of 2018. Over and over, he has done this. So yeah, he's trying to do that sleazy stuff. But the point is, like, you see what I'm saying is, like, all of the evidence is from before and after. There's right. a hole in right. the memoir. There's a hole in the communications. There's a hole in what the women say, except for Hallie Biden. Hallie Biden, she went to a rehab event with Hunter on October 6th. So before he bought the gun.
Okay.
And then her testimony as delivered says that Hunter Biden was out and came into her house overnight, October 22. And then she went and dropped the kids off at school, came back, saw his truck, and wanted to search it for drugs.
Okay.
And that's what led her to search the truck, find the gun. She throws the gun out. And so that testimony is, and she describes, he came in overnight and, you know, I thought that he might have done drugs. There are two texts that Hunter sent her where she said, "Who are you with?" And the question was, "Are you fucking some other woman?"
Right.
And his response was, "I'm with Mookie, the drug dealer." And so the question is, when he said, "I'm with Mookie, the drug dealer," was he really with Mookie, the drug dealer, or was he just telling Hallie to fuck off? Because they were telling each other to fuck off a lot in that period.
Wow.
So these are the evidence that Hunter Biden was doing crack in the 11 days he owned the gun are the Mookie, the drug dealer text and another one to Hallie. Hallie's claim that he came in overnight, October 22nd, seemingly having done drugs. And then that led her to search the truck and find the gun and throw out the gun. And then there's a text not long after where she describes finding one of his pipes. This is after the 23rd. Now, you know, did he do drugs after the 23rd because of the stress of having to talk to the cops? And then the one other thing prosecutors are pointing to is the fact that he made a bunch of cash withdrawals in this period. And so they are using cash withdrawals as proxy for buying drugs. It's reasonable,
yes.
But this is circumstantial evidence. Okay. And that's Hallie's testimony as it was delivered. Now, yesterday, Abby Lowell tried really. So prosecutors cherry pick all these comms, right? They get the Mookie, the drug dealer one.
Mm-hmm.
And then admittedly, Hunter Biden's team didn't give a list of exhibits to prosecutors, although they were in conversations. And then yesterday morning, there was a fight about how many of their digital communications could come in because they wanted to counter. They wanted to show a number of things, but the thing that they wanted to show most of all was that Hunter didn't sleep at Hallie Biden's overnight on October 22nd and 23rd.
Okay.
And if they can show that, then it means her claim that he came in the middle of the night and it seemed like he had been doing drugs, which is the only time she saw him in the period when he owned the gun.
Huh.
Okay. If they can prove that, then her claim that she searched the truck for drugs falls down. Now the cop in his original arrest report claims Hallie told him she searched the truck because she wanted to find whether he was fucking another woman.
Okay.
So if Hunter wasn't with her, she saw the truck, she searched the truck to see if there was a sign of another woman, then that direct testimony of somebody who saw Hunter Biden thinking he had done drugs begins to fall apart. As we speak, Naomi Biden is testifying and then James Biden is expected to testify and then we'll be done with evidence. One of the things.
Oh, I was going to say, you mentioned James Biden. Another development this week is the, I don't know which committee, Jim Jordan, maybe a subpoena.
The asshole committee. Yeah.
Right.
I mean,
subpoenaed Hunter Biden and James Biden and didn't Jim Jordan not show up for his congressional subpoena? I mean, hypocrisy here is just stunning. But they're pushing forward with, you know, going after them. So that was another development this week.
And that's a frivolous thing because, you know, there's already a special prosecutor appointed. They reviewed Hunter's testimony. If he actually perjured himself, they're going to charge him regardless. They don't need a referral. But the fact that the referral came in over the week makes it, you know, adds to the 100 million reasons why Hunter Biden won't take the stand in his own defense. Because if he did, prosecutors could say, oh, you just got a criminal referral for lying.
Right.
So, you know, he probably wasn't going to take the stand anyway, but I think that makes now it even more less likely. So for example, Naomi Biden is going to explain, she's going to rebut Ali's testimony about the state of the truck. She actually just did. Again,
okay,
we're taping in midday East Coast time. She is rebutting Hallie's testimony about the state of the truck when she found the truck. I think she is going to rebut Hallie's statement about the state of the console where she found the gun. So they are going to undermine Hallie Biden's testimony. Like, I think jurors might have reasonable doubt about whether Hunter Biden did crack during that week.
Right.
You know, I think prosecutors have made a strong circumstantial case that he did. But I think, you know, there is certainly a way to believe that he and Hunter's team is arguing that, sure, he was drinking that week, but he's struggled with alcohol longer than he did with crack. He was drinking that week, but it's not in America. It's not illegal to buy a gun if you're an alcoholic.
Right.
You can buy a, you know, you just can't, you can't buy a gun. You can't even buy a gun if you smoke dope. But you can buy a gun. Anyway, so that's the strategy. And that's, you know, that's how you undermine Hallie Biden's testimony. The problem with that, and I said this, right? 11 days, was he either using crack cocaine or was he an addict in that period?
Right.
I think that the jury is going to have a hard time saying he wasn't an addict in that period. It's easy to say that Hunter Biden didn't believe his addiction was such that he couldn't buy a gun on October 11th at the moment he checked that form. And there are about eight other ways that his team has undermined the two document cases, the document charges against him. But on the possession one, I think that the case is a strong circumstantial case. And I would be unsurprised if the jury convicted him on that charge. Now, that's the charge that could be thrown out by the Supreme Court. And there are two ways for him to appeal that charge. If the Supreme Court throws out the charge as a whole, then he's off. But he can also, and is, launching an as-applied challenge. So in other words, if I am a high-functioning addict who is in a moment of sobriety, how can you tell me I can't own a gun? And so that's where that appeal goes forward. They're still going to appeal the diversion agreement. You know, one of the other things to know about this is they succeeded in getting the tax case bumped to September. And so if he's found guilty, can he appeal the diversion agreement, which covers both tax and gun crimes?
Okay.
And get that decided before the Los Angeles trial starts.
So if both cases haven't been heard yet, I thought you can only file an appeal after sentencing.
I don't know whether they're going to be able to do the diversion one before sentencing, but in any case, point being that there's a possibility he can get the Third Circuit to review the diversion agreement, the contract.
Right.
I think that Judge Noriega's decision there is pretty weak. And if that decision is overturned, if he's immune, then it puts the Los Angeles trial in an awkward position, because the Ninth Circuit hasn't sided with Biden, but the contract is a Delaware contract. If the contract is thrown out in Delaware, I mean, if the contract is upheld in Delaware, then it prohibits prosecution in Los Angeles as well.
Okay.
So that's like, I'm not like Hunter Biden. I emphasize this all the time. He's in a world of hurt.
Yes.
He has one of the best lawyers in the country. There are surprising holes in a case that was brought against the son of the president, you know, and this is what I've been saying. I mean, like, I knew that there's the garbage about the doctored form, right? I knew that. Like, I knew, and I expect there are 10 other things that eventually will come out to show that if he had known all of the problems with the investigation, it would never have gone to trial. But right now, he only knows a tiny bit of it. But, you know, as I was looking at the evidence, there's just this big hole in those 11 days. There is a big hole. They don't have direct witnesses saying that he was doing crack cocaine in those 11 days. And so I think a jury could find it, you know, at least hang or something. But then there's also the, did he know he was an addict in those 11 days? And I think that, again, I think it's not unlikely that a jury is going to convict him of that.
Wow. I mean, the whole case is such bullshit that, you know, the fact that they're bringing, and I feel like a hypocrite saying it, because the Trump case is something, you know, the one he was just found guilty on 34 counts, that is also not routinely prosecuted. And in fact, the way they came up with the felony to make the misdemeanors into a felony is a novel prosecution.
Well, be careful. The document side of it is routine. Mm-hmm. Alvin Bragg has brought a ton of those cases. This is what you do in New York City if you're the business capital of the United States. So that charge itself is not novel at all.
Sure.
It's how you get there, because the specific crimes in which Trump was prosecuted on happened to do with him being president.
The and election, so, right. And
yeah,
right.
Yeah. I mean, it's really important to remember that, though, because it is routine. Like the document side of it, the altering documents,
right.
That is routine in New York City.
It was the election routine. Interference part of it that makes these misdemeanors into felonies, I believe.
Yeah, it's yes. Yes.
Yes. But I would
it's
say
the crime
that
he was trying to cover up.
That's a whole lot more serious than this bullshit trumped up, charges against Bo Biden for something that's never prosecuted. He owned the gun
Hunter
for 11,
yeah.
Hunter Biden.
Yeah, I mean, look, let's talk about it this way, though. Joe Biden's kid, Joe Biden has pushed gun laws. You know, Biden, under Joe Biden, they are cracking down on rich tax cheats.
Yes.
So I am sympathetic to anybody who wants to argue that you have to try Hunter Biden because Joe Biden has particularly pushed those two laws that his son is charged with. I am very sympathetic with that.
Yep.
What I'm not sympathetic with is burying the evidence that this of all of the corruption that got here. Right. So I'm sympathetic. If it were a pristine case, I would be absolutely supportive of it, because I think you cannot have a man say, you know, everyone else should be held to these gun laws, but my son.
Right. I agree.
What I am saying is that the case is riddled with all sorts of other corruption, and now we can return and then, you know, I'll let you off and you can go back to bed. The coverage of this has been abysmal. It's just been shoddy because, like, you know, everyone has had a nonstop dick pic sniffing brigade for 18 months,
mm-hmm.
right? We have done nothing but report about Hunter Biden since Republicans took over Congress. And honestly, we have done nothing but report about Hunter Biden since 2018.
Right.
Like everyone. And Will Lewis, by the way, and Will Lewis, who's under a lot of heat right now for being corrupt. He was interviewed by Ben Smith, back in January, and Ben Smith said, how do you avoid being perceived as biased? And Will Lewis, now under heat for being corrupt, said, oh, look at this great Hunter Biden story that Matt Visser reported on. And that Hunter Biden story didn't confess. I talked about how what we thought we knew about Hunter Biden's art sales, none of it was true.
Uh-huh.
Where we learned what we thought we knew about Hunter Biden's art sales came from Matt Visser. So Matt Visser misrepresented Hunter Biden's art sales and led everyone to believe that there was some corrupt angle to it. That wasn't true. And so what Will Lewis was pointing to was Matt Visser not confessing that he ruined Hunter Biden's life and ruined this Trump-supporting art gallerist to invent this claim of corruption that didn't hold up. Like, mm-hmm. And so this is the point is, so let me go through the cases. I talked about New York Times saying, oh, no one's been charged. No one that Trump personally targeted has been charged. That's nonsense.
Right.
The NBC in particular. So Garrett Ziegler, the guy who cracked the password on a phone that is part of the laptop and has posted everything that is associated with any Biden family that is even remotely salacious. He is at the trial. And Hunter Biden's wife saw him at the trial. He has used anti-Semitic slurs against Hunter Biden's wife. And of course, he's part of this mob scene that when she was pregnant led like helicopters flying over their house. This is part of how Kevin Morris got involved in the first place. He's like, this woman's pregnant.
Yeah.
And you guys are 24/7 harassing them. We need to get them where they can have some privacy and bring this pregnancy to term. So Garrett Ziegler is a part of that. He's using anti-Semitic slurs against Hunter Biden's wife. And she called him a Nazi.
Yep.
And that's one of the big stories, like this NBC.
Yeah, that got more coverage than the trial itself, right?
Than the trial. And none of them are covering the legal aspects. None of them. Zero. Not even the people who ostensibly know something about the law, like Washington Post's Perry Stein. And they're missing, like, I'm the only one who's covered the fact that the gun shop owner got immunity. Now, it probably came up today. But when people describe Garrett Ziegler, they don't describe him as somebody who, by his own admission, cracked a password to access phone data and then post it publicly. Like, wow. I'm not saying that what he did could be criminal hacking. Hunter Biden is suing him on the logic that it's criminal hacking. We'll see. But I mean, you know, Ziegler actually has a fairly interesting legal response to that, which is that since Hunter never owned the drive on which the encrypted phone got to him, he didn't hack his device. It'll be an interesting lawsuit. But regardless, what he did is not just taking files and posting them. And yet every single outlet that reported this exchange between Hunter Biden's wife and Garrett Ziegler pitched him as like, oh, a nice Trump supporter who just posted some files. Oh, it's obscene. Please. It is obscene that journalists whitewashed what Garrett Ziegler did. I mean, it's just, I have nothing but contempt for the people who are like, oh, just a nice Peter Navarro, a young Peter Navarro. He's also, of course, the guy who let Mike Flynn into the White House on December 18th, 2020, you know, like Garrett, like even the right wing hates Garrett Ziegler. And yet you guys right. whitewashed him so that you could make Hunter Biden's wife look unreasonable for calling him a Nazi. That's gross. Yep, the other thing that's gross is Perry Stein, who's the least awful of the three main dick pic sniffers at Washington Post. The other two being Matt Visor, who didn't admit that he ruined the gallerist's, you know, business, and Devlin Barrett, who is always a right wing, you know, he's always a mouthpiece for right wing law enforcement and has been in this case. Perry Stein is not as bad as those two, but Perry Stein, when she describes John Paul MacIsaac, you know, like snooping through Hunter Biden's stuff,
yeah,
and then sharing the entire, you know, making hard drive after hard drive after hard drive and disseminating it, and from there getting disseminated. You know, again, there's a lawsuit. We'll see whether that amounts to some kind of serious enough privacy violation that Hunter Biden can take whoever is funding John Paul MacIsaac to the cleaners. But It is a gross privacy violation to go snooping through somebody's computer, whether or not you think he legally owned it, which is still very much a question. It's just disgusting. It's gross.
And now
Perry Stein, who's the least corrupt, the least problematic of these dick pic sniffers at Washington Post, was like, oh, he's sort of a whistleblower. I'm like, are you crazy? Insane? No, he's not a whistleblower at all. He's a hack partisan who is part of one of the most obscene hit jobs in certainly the 21st century. And you called him a sort of whistleblower. it's basically, I call it Tiger Beat reporting. I mean, what they have been obsessed with. They've been obsessed with, here's the beautiful Biden who showed up. Like, Jill Biden has made all but yesterday.
Yes.
Because she's the D-Day response. Jill Biden's been there. A couple of the, you know, kids, wife, like Hunter Biden's wife comes to trial every day.
Right.
Didn't happen in Trump's case.
No, like, it
no
didn't.
One talked about the fact that Melania never once showed up.
I know.
No right. one, you know, so they're talking about, here's what Jill Biden wore to her son's trial, which they, by the way, didn't do with, say, Alina Haba, who's as right. much of a looker, right? She's there. She's there. And they're not saying, let's compare these two. This is like what you're seeing in the Hunter Biden case is unconditional love. You are seeing them like every time the family they take a showing break, up they hug to each support, other, they kiss each other, they, you know, they're crying. This is like, this is what love looks like.
Yeah.
And in the Trump trial, every day, like the reason Eric Trump shows up, the reason Don Jr. shows up, the reason, you know, members of Congress show up is to attack rule of law.
Yes.
And how is it that you can't contrast those two things, attacking rule of law and unconditional love and facing trial? Like,
right.
How is it that you are so inept that you can't, it's the middle of a campaign season, that you can't contrast those two things?
Right. It seems common sense.
It just infuriates me.
The other thing is the Washington Post is probably going to just keep getting worse because the there was a big shakeup there this week where the executive editor, Sally Busby, quickly out and replaced by a former Wall Street Journal editor. I think Politico called it the Rupert Murdochization of the Washington Post. So,
yeah, no, I mean, and it's happening everywhere,
yes,
right? Like the Wall Street Journal is doing this as well. The Wall Street Journal, in the one place where the changes aren't being led by a white male, but the Wall Street Journal keeps eliminating key beats like the border beat or beats focused on Latinos, or, you know, they're getting rid of many of the non-white journalists.
Wow.
And, it is what is happening in journalism today is terrifying.
Yep.
With the Washington Post, I can't help but think, you know, with shitty coverage like this, I mean, they have literally, like, Washington Post and NBC, I believe, have a policy that says, we don't care if we don't really accurately cover Hunter Biden. We don't care if we don't cover the scandal of the way we got here, because, you know, these are our two categories. There's the Trump and there's the Hunter Biden crimes, and we have to fill both their spaces. The reporting isn't the same. I mean, the reporting in Trump's case in New York was exceptional. There were exceptional legal reporters there,
right,
and they would describe to you on a daily basis. Like, I remember Anna Bauer's Lawfare, as soon as, I'm trying to think what it was, there was some piece of evidence that came in, and Anna Bauer's like, oh, this is why they're doing it.
Uh-huh.
This is exactly why. And sure enough, that's why they were doing it.
Right.
There's none of that. There's like, these people don't understand even what the elements of the offense are, what prosecutors have to charge. Right. And so you see people out there all the time going, oh my God, look at all the drug use. I'm like, but none of the drug use is from October 2018. You need to show the drug use in October of 2018, and they haven't done that. I mean, they're, you know, I grant that there is a strong circumstantial case, but you know, it's just incompetence and salaciousness. It is infuriating. It is infuriating that this is the end. You can think that Hunter Biden should be prosecuted. Mm-hmm. You can think that this is, you know, that he needs to be prosecuted to show that Joe Biden's kid gets the same treatment that other gun crimes would. I am very sympathetic with that, but you should not at the same time ignore how we got here.
Right.
And, you know, and everybody is, and because everybody is, Trump is getting an enormous pass. Trump personally intervened in this case and no one wants to talk about it. Nobody.
No. And that's why it's so important that the work you're doing, Marcy Wheeler, and I appreciate it more and more, because again, I look and I'm not seeing any coverage. The only comprehensive coverage that I'm seeing from an objective journalist, you know, taking all the right wing crap out of the way, is yours at emptywheel.net. So thank you for doing this. And it's such a weird case. I always talk about the projection by Trump and his camp. Everything they're saying that the government is doing to him, the persecution and all that, is exactly what they are doing and what he's promising to do more of should he get back in the White House.
Right. I mean, that's the thing. That is the thing. Under Trump already, you can have individuals picked out and have 8-year campaigns against them.
Yeah.
In this case, so I guess 6-year campaigns against them to not just prosecute them, but to humiliate them.
Yes.
To make that the order of government.
Yeah.
Like the only thing the House GOP has done is sniff Hunter Biden's dick pics. That's it. That's the only thing they have done for the entire 18 months that they've had the majority. And that is what Trump wants.
Yeah.
And, you know, like there has been some commentary like, oh, did prosecutors overstep showing all of this stuff? And I wouldn't be surprised if Abby Lowell gets up there on Monday in closing arguments and says, you know, they wasted 8 hours of your time showing you evidence that post-dates the gun, that is irrelevant to the question of what Hunter Biden's mindset was in those 11 days in October right. of 2018. But because of the, you know, like, and that's the point, like the 2016 to 2019 stuff, all of that stuff, getting as many naked pictures and crack pipes into the public record on a court docket, that's not just about the case, because mm-hmm. it actually doesn't prove the case. It is about humiliating Hunter yes. Biden. It is about raising the cost for him of going to trial. And, you know, and I think that may make the jury more likely to nullify. And again, I'm not saying they should. I'm saying this is a weird case, but yes. I am saying journalists should be reporting on the fact that 70% of the prosecution's evidence was irrelevant to the charges, wow. utterly irrelevant to the charges.
Wow. The whole thing is just, and it's compounding because of all the other stuff that they're doing all the while accusing the president, the Democrats, of doing to them exactly what they're doing.
Right.
It's opposite world.
And that's the problem. Like, if New York Times can say no one that Trump targeted has been prosecuted, you're letting Trump off
right.
for the clearest cut case of what he wants to do. Mm. And, you know, and I've laid into them for this. It is so corrupt not to say Hunter Biden is on trial and this is what Trump wants. This is what yes. a Trump term right. means. We are all Hunter Biden if Trump wins again. And no one will report it. It's infuriating.
Well,
I'm sorry,
no one
I'm
but you.
Let you go, Nicole, because yeah. I have to go rugby. Yeah. I have to go watch a rugby match.
You go rugby. I'm going to go back to sleep. I apologize for being so out of it today, but drugs. See what
we
drugs do to you? And this is from a doctor.
Yeah, don't do drugs.
Yeah.
Only do
the good
cannabis,
ones.
So.
Right, yeah. And not...
do cannabis.
which I do, and maybe that would set me straight. I don't know. I'm going to go back to bed. Marcy Wheeler, thank you so much. Enjoy your rugby match. And we will talk again next week.
Take care.
You too. Bye.